Everyone, in this video we are going to study about the next concept, that is the interpreter files. So these are the interpreter, what do you mean by interpreter files? These are the files which will be included during the time of the execution of the scripts, shell scripts, whatever you are having, those it will be included. Without converting it into the object code, those programming's part will be run, and these interpreter files, these are the text files. These text files, how to understand, these are the interpreter files, or this is a interpreter. So it always begins with a hash exclamation mark followed by a path name and optional argument. Hash exclamation mark is the indicator that it is a interpreter file, followed by the path name. The path name is a the path name here is a absolute path name, since it is beginning with the slash symbol. So after hash exclamation mark, we are going to write the path name. So please remember, this is a path name. Here we could have used the path variable. We could have used the path variable. What is path variable giving? It is giving you the sequence in which the command will be searched into the system, into the Unix system. But here we are not specifying any command, but we are specifying the name of a file which should be included as an interpreter in our program. So this is the example here, hash exclamation slash bin slash sh. So this is the path name given and it is beginning. So this is an interpreter. So now we are having interpreter and interpreter file. We should be able to differentiate between these two. Interpreter file means the file which is to be included in the program. Here file is not specified. Here file is not specified. Only the interpreter is specified. So this is an interpreter here. Let us take one example. Example program we can take here. So in this example program, you can see directly I will start from the main here. So in that we are having a PID is representing the process ID of the whether it is a child or whether it is a parent. We are going to find it using this PID. Then in this, if PID is equal to fork, fork means what here? We are creating a child process. When the child process is created and the PID is less than the zero, whether it is a parent or whether it is a child, but if the process ID of that is less than zero, then it is an error. Means what? Fork has not created a child process. Otherwise, if this is false, if it is not less than 0, we are checking for PID is equal to 0. What do you mean by when PID is equal to 0? It means that it is a child process. So always a child will return a 0 and parent is returning the child's PID. This we have studied in the beginning of this module. So what we are going to do here is we are checking whether the PID is 0. If the PID is 0, it means that child has started executing. Child is created using the fork system call, and then it is the child process which starts its execution. Next we are having here, if exec, what is this one? Execl means it is the execute function with L. L means it is replacing whatever the current is. This is the current one. So home slash sar slash bin slash test interrupt, this is the first executing one, currently executing one. This will be replaced by the image of this file. This will be replaced by the image of this file. Means execution of this will be stopped and the next will be taken for execution. And here another two arguments we are passing. Then if this condition is false, if it is not a if it is not executing using this exec, then error should be generated, that is execl error. Then wait PID, PID null means what it is doing here? Wait PID means the here parent is waiting until the child is completing its execution. If it is not waiting, then if this condition is false, then we are going to return an error. So we will see see the output of this one, then you will understand it easily. So now in this file, see test interp, we are cat command we are using. Using the cat command, we are going to display the contents of this test interp. What is present in this test interp? This is present. What is that? #! This path name and the name of the file. Okay. So now this is an interpreter file. Foo is an interpreter file, whereas !! and this path name is an interpreter. It is an interpreter. This is an interpreter file. So now, if we are executing, see, I told you, no, !! and path name followed by an optional argument. This optional argument here is a foo. This foo means it is indicating that it is an interpreter file. Now I am executing the previous program, that is .a.out. So what it is doing? It is going to display the different arguments. argv of 0, it is taking the first argument. argv of 1, see, it is the second argument. Then argv of 2, it is printing the interpreter. ARG of 3. So now here you can see here. So in this program, whatever the arguments are given, this is first argument, second argument, third argument, fourth argument. So all these arguments will be printed. So now what we are doing, see here, we are printing the first, second, third, fourth and fifth. See, in between we are having this interpreter print first. Remaining will be the whatever arguments we are passing in the program. See here, these are the arguments we are passing. So these arguments will be printed in the output. It is echoing. Echo arg is a name of the program which we are going to execute. So when we are executing this, it is going to print all the arguments. So whatever arguments we have passed in the program, those arguments will be printed. So what are interpreter file? See, when you are executing using such kind of statements, that time interpreter file will be executed using the exec. So using the execl or any version of execute function, so using those the interpreter files will be executed. Those will be done by the kernel. The kernel, as a part of processing, kernel will process all these interpreter files. Interpreter files are the text files that are always beginning with the !! So this is what we have to keep in mind. Next, we will be studying about the system function. So now suppose sometimes in a file, if you want to insert a command, and when you are executing that file, that command also should be executed. So if this situation comes, that time system will come into picture. System function we are using at that time. Let us take one example here. Suppose we want to insert the date and time. If you want to insert the timestamp in the program, then what is to be done? So we have to follow the series of steps. So what series of steps? First, we have to call the time, means we have to call the time command to get the current calendar. So after that, we are calling again the local time command to convert that into broken down. See, whenever we are getting the time, it will display the calendar. Calendar means what? Month, date, year, time stamp will be displayed. But I want only the time stamp here. For that purpose, we are breaking it down. Once it is broken down, then again we are calling strf time. Why we are calling this? This is called for formatting into the required format. See, we want the time like time in hours, minutes, seconds. So like this we want in some format. So to do that formatting, we are calling this function. See, we have already called three commands here now. To execute only one command in our file, we are calling the three commands here. So to avoid that, we are going for the system function. So if we are using this system function, if you write using any redirection operation, see this is date. Date is, we are using this redirection operation, means it is output. It is the output. Whatever date we are getting, that date will be placed in this file. So like this we are using here. What is the syntax? Its syntax is int system constant character command string. This command string is having a pointer, means it is returning a zero or it is returning some error. How we will return, let us see now here. So it is, we are passing only the command string here. Address of that command string in the form of a pointer is been passed for this system function here. So command string means here, like example I told you now, date here. Date is a command. So we are passing that command to this system function. How this will work? So this system function is executed by calling three functions, fork, execute and wait PID. So using these three functions, the system function will be executed. Now if any one of this will be failing, then it will cause an error. Let us see how. If either of the fork fails or wait PID fails, if fork or wait PID, any one of these two, if it is failing, then an error will be returned. That is, a minus one will be returned. If any one fork or wait PID, if they will fail, means fork will fail means what? It cannot create a child, because there are so many reasons why we do not create a child. One may be that each process will be assigned total number of child processes it can create. Maybe already those total number of child processes are already created. That is why the fork has failed. Fork has failed to create the new child process. Wait PID. What do you mean by wait PID? Wait PID means that process will wait, the parent will wait until the child is to be completed its execution. Suppose this also will fail, then a minus one will be returned. Coming to exec. So if exec fail, what it is doing? Shell cannot be exec means what? It is going to execute some functions. It is going to execute. See, system command string, we want to execute this command string. But if this execute function only fails, what will be written? The return value of the exit will be returned. See, exit 127. So this is the value which will be returned. Exit 127 means the exec function will be failed. Now, like for example, whenever you are searching some web pages into your internet, that time 404 error will be there, no? Page not found. Like that, whenever the exec will be failing, exit 127 will be the return value. Otherwise, if all three functions are working properly, fork, execute and wait PID, if they are succeeding and the return value from the system is the termination status of the shell, means what? When all these three functions are working well, at that time what will be the return value of this system? The return value will be the termination status of that process. Termination status means what? When the process executes and exits normally, that time there will be some return value to the operating system. So that return value will be given when all these three functions will work properly. So in general, this system function is used to insert any command into our file, and during the execution, when we are using the execute command, that command string will be executed automatically. This system function is avoiding including of many commands. To get one output, we require several different commands individually to be executed in the file. But to avoid that, we are using this system. Here you can see the example program. So here what we are doing, command string, for directly we will be starting from the main here, system function. See, system, constant string, command string. This command string is read from the standard input. From the user itself it is read here. Then if command string is null, whatever you are entering, if it is null, what it means that when the command string is null, always the command processor will return a 1. When the command is null, it will return a 1. Suppose now we are doing, see, I told fork, execute and wait PID. These are the three functions which are used for executing this command string in the file. First we are taking of the fork function. If the fork function is executed successfully, means it is returning a 0. When it is returning a 0, what we are doing, I want to execute this function. I want to execute. See, again we are having EXECL. EXECL means what? It replaces one process with another process, that in the binary format, okay, in the executable binary file it will be. One file will be replaced by the another file. Then we are having a minus C. Minus C will tell you what it will tell. A minus C option will tell to take the next command line argument. Whatever the user is entering through the keyboard command, that command is taken using this minus C. And that command will be executed. If that command fails, then exit minus 127 will be used here. Now see, we are using an underscore exit. So there are two types of exit functions. One is only exit, another is a underscore exit. So what does this underscore exit mean? It means that it returns immediately. No cleanup will be done. Cleanup means what? So whatever resources are held by this process will not be freed. Immediately the control will be returned to the parent or the main process. If you are using only exit, that time whatever resources that have been used by this process will be freed first, made available to other processes, then it will be terminated. But here we are using the underscore exit, means the control is returned immediately without doing any cleanup. So now we have finished with the fork, EXECL, then we are having the wait PID. If the wait PID functions properly, then we are going to execute the command. If it is not functioning properly, then we are going to have an error status of minus 1. So this is how the system function is working. Next we are having about the process accounting. Process accounting means what? Whenever a termination of any process takes place, that time we should maintain some record related to that process. Is it not? So what is the termination status? What is its process ID which has been terminated? Then what is its CPU time? What is the time spent in the CPU? How much time the system has given to the process? All these records should be maintained. Next question is, why these records should be maintained? Sometimes what happens is, whenever a child is terminating, parent does not know. Parent does not know that the child is terminating. Then if the parent wants the record of its child, then from where it will get the record? Is it not? So for that purpose, process accounting is required. Who is maintaining this account? It is kept in the kernel table. There is a kernel table which will be updated every time a process is terminated, and once a process is terminated, that time these all accounts record will be generated. So now here we are having a function. Function called as AACT, act. This function is used for turning on the process accounting, and even you can disable this process accounting. Enabling and disabling of this process accounting can also be done. How it is done? By using the act on. By using this one, if you are using the act on, by using the act on, a super user is allowed, only super user is allowed to record these accounting of the processes. Enabling and disabling is done by the super user only. Act on with a path name argument is used for enabling the accounting. Act on with the path name. So act on space we are using a path name. For that particular path, we are enabling the process accounting. Suppose if you want to disable, how do you disable? Again, you are using the act on, but you are not using any arguments. If you are not using any arguments, then accounting of that processes will be stopped. How this is done is all the details regarding the accounting are present into these structures. So what we are having? We are having a user ID, group user ID, what terminal it is using, then what is the calendar time, what is its CPU time, what is its system CPU time, how much time has elapsed, what is the average memory, then bytes transferred, what is the IO transfer be done. So all these accounts, see, these are the details regarding the terminated processes. We are having flag here, AC underscore flag. This is a flag which is going to take the different accounts. What type of accounts? What type of events? A fork event. What is this A fork event? It means that the process is a result of a fork but never called EXEC. Means this can be there are many processes which are created but they are not executed at that time. For those processes A fork will be set to 1. ASU means process used super user privileges. There are many processes which change their user IDs and become the super user. For such processes, ASU flag will be set. This AC underscore flag will take any one of these values. Then when this accounting will be displayed, once the process will terminate, this account details can be retrieved. So all these account details are present in the kernel's process table. So in the process table, we will be having the record of all these details. Then when these account details are created, when any new process is created, that time the account details will be created. What is this? The order of the records in the accounting file corresponds to the termination. See, the order creation is done during the time of its process creation, but when it will be found, means when the termination of those processes happens, that time only we can get the account details. So next concept in this only here is the account records correspond to the process, not programs. Means whenever a new process is created, that time only the accounting can be done. If you are start same process, if it starts executing a new program, accounting will not be done. It will be done only when the fork system call. So what they're saying, a new record is initialized by the kernel for child after a fork, not when a new program is executed. If the same process is executing 10 programs, then 10 accounts will not be there. Only one account details will be there because it is only single process. If you are using a fork system call, what do you mean by fork? It is creating a new child process. So when you are creating a new child process, that time only the accounting is allowed. Now you can see an example here. So in this example, program A is executing program B, then it executes C, then C will finish executing. So here there are three programs executing, A, B and C. Here three account details will not be maintained. Only one account detail will be maintained. These are programs. These are not processes. So the one process can execute many programs. So all these programs come under only a single process. So only one account will be there. Only one account details will be there. Now in this example, you can see here, fork system call is done 1, 2, 3, 4 times. Means three children will be created. That time, three account details will be maintained. Why? Because fork means it is creating a new child. When a new child is created, new process is initiated. When a new process is initiated, the accounting will be done. Each of the child is doing some special work it is doing, and then it is exiting. So when it is terminating, at that time account details can be fetched. So this is the example for process accounting. Process accounting gives the details regarding the different usage of the system by the processes. Account detailing is done only for a process but not the programs. And what is the order in which the account details will be maintained? The order of termination. When they will terminate, depending on that the accounting will be done here. Even if the process is created first, its account detailing is not done first. When it will terminate, so the order is termination wise, not the creation wise. Next concept to be studied here is about the user identification. Now we have seen how to get the user ID, but how to identify the user? So how to identify the user means login name. How to identify the login name? The same user, the same, when you are you can have many user IDs under the same login. You can create, you want to find out the login name, who is running the program. That time we can we are using this get login function for understanding who has logged in as the main user under different process IDs or under the different user. See, using the one login name you can have different password files, is it not? Different passwords can be present, so you can renew your password, you can give your new password, is it not? So who has logged in, to find out the user who has logged in, to find the login name of that particular user, we are going to use this get login void. It is returning a pointer to the string giving the login name. If this function is executing successfully, that time we are going to get a pointer. Pointer means what? It is telling you the address where the login name is present. Otherwise a null pointer will be returned. Null means it is not executing properly. The function can fail if the process is not attached to the terminal. If any login is done and that login user is not executing any process using the terminal, that time this command will fail, and such type of processes are called as daemon processes, or they are called as daemons. Daemons means what? Daemons means those processes which are executing but not attached to the terminal. They are not using the terminal for execution. So such processes are called as daemon processes. So user identification is to find out the login name of the user who is running the program. So next, lastly, we are going to study about the process times. So we are having three types of process times here. One is wall clock time, means what is the time on the clock when you are executing. So that is the wall clock time. Then you can get the CPU, user CPU time, how much the user is using the CPU. Next, system CPU time. System CPU time means how much the system is using the CPU or how much it is investing for execution of the processes. So these three process times can be got by using this times function. By using the times function, we can get the these three values here. So it is having the struct TMS. So TMS is a structure which is going to give you different process time. What is present in this TMS structure? In this TMS structure, we are having the U time, means the user CPU time. S time means the system CPU time. Cut CU time means user CPU time of the terminated children. CS time means system CPU time of the terminated children. So I told you that we are having three clock times. One is wall clock time, means the clock on the time, the time on the clock, CPU time and system time. Here we are getting user time and system time, but nowhere we are getting the clock time. Where do we get this clock time then? Whenever we are executing this times function, always it is returning the wall clock time. It is always returning the wall clock time. But this wall clock time return is not exact. It is just in terms of seconds. Okay. When you are returning this, it may be 45. What does 45 mean? 45 seconds. It does not mean the system has started and now the time on the clock is 45 seconds. It is not like that. It is saying for how much time that process is running. So exact wall clock time also is not got, but we can get the relative time. How do we get the relative time? What we are doing is, for the first time we are executing this times function, and one value will be got. Suppose that value is 45. One more time we are executing this time function, that time we may get something 80. The difference of these two is the wall clock time. So it is not the exact wall clock time we are getting as the return value, we will be getting the relative value. So we will be getting the relative value. The difference of the wall clock time is taken. Once it is executed, second time it is executing. The difference of these two time it is taken, and we are going to get the relative value. And whatever in seconds we are having, see here, the clock underscore t values returned to these functions are converted to seconds using this function. So whatever values we are getting, so it is in terms of ticks per second. It is clock ticks per second. But we do not, all of them do not understand clock ticks per second. Either they should be converted into minutes, hours, or to the seconds. So here we are converting into seconds by using this sc_sc_clock_tck. This is the function which is used to convert the clock ticks per second into seconds. So this completes your first chapter here.